Jesus constantly told his disciples that a spirit would come. And I'm sure they were wondering, well, what will this spirit do? What will it be like? What will this spirit help us? How will it help us? Well, what does the spirit do is a good question also for our own time. And so we go back to the scriptures, which actually are God's spirit speaking to us to find the answer. And so when we go to the book of Genesis, it says the earth was a formless wasteland and darkness covered the abyss. Bleak, a dark, awful place. And yet the Holy Spirit enters into this darkness, into the abyss, and everything changes. There's now light where there used to be darkness. The waters have separated from the land, and now there's land and water, and instead of just water and nothing else. There are all kinds of living things now, animals, plants, and the pinnacle of creation, human beings. Also now, everything is in order. God creates on particular days and creates particular things on those days. So now everything is in order, and now everything will grow because of the gift of the Spirit. That is the Spirit's work. It is creative and it makes things grow in the world. And so it is for us as well. The Spirit comes to our world, and as we look around our world, we see that there is disorder. There is a wasteland of violence everywhere, in every single part of our world. There's the darkness of racism and poverty. There's the abyss of division and war. Things are out of order in our world and need the Spirit's order very badly. And so we gather here this morning and we pray that that Spirit may help us to achieve order, to help us to conquer the darkness that surrounds us, and fill us and the world with light. There's also a story in the book of Ezekiel where God tells Ezekiel to go preach in this particular place, and he goes to that place, and what does he find? As far as the eye can see, there's nothing but dry bones. It's like the middle of the desert, and you see just bones everywhere. It gets him a little depressed, as you might imagine. And God tells him, preach to these dry bones. And I'm sure he's scratching his head saying, why would I do that? These bones are dead, they're dry, there's no possibility of anything getting any better in this place. But he does it. He starts to tell the dry bones that have no ears, can't listen to them. He starts to tell the dry bones of the story of God, how God loves us and cares for us. And all of a sudden, he hears a sound. That is, the bones start to tremble. And they come together, and then flesh grows on them, and sinew grows on them, and the Spirit raises what was dead and dry and gone and forgotten, and raises those bones to new life because of the Word of God. And so we also sometimes have dry bones that surround us. We might say that there is no hope, no possibility of hope in a particular part of our lives. But if we let that word in, if we let that word inspire us, fill us, then there is always the possibility of new life with God. Well, we know that God has created out of nothing with the Holy Spirit, has risen to new life with the Holy Spirit, but the Spirit also challenges us each and every day. The person I think most of all of in this time after Easter, in terms of the Spirit and its challenges, is St. Peter. Certainly all of the disciples are challenged, but Peter especially. After Jesus' resurrection and ascension, Peter goes to the house of a Roman soldier. And while he is talking to the soldier, the Holy Spirit doesn't visit Peter. The Holy Spirit falls upon this Roman soldier and the members of his house. And Peter is saying, this is unthinkable. The Romans? The Romans who have come in and killed so many? The Romans who have taken over our land? They're receiving the gift of the Holy Spirit? How is this possible? For For thousands of years, we have been told that we are the chosen people and God is with us always, that we are God's beloved and nobody else. We have a covenant with him that Abraham made. The Romans didn't do that, but still the Holy Spirit goes to the Romans and fills this Roman soldier up and changes his life. And Peter is thinking, pagans, this is horrible. How in the world are we going to live now? This is a great challenge for Peter. He has to change his mindset, has to change the belief that he and his ancestors have held for thousands of years. And the Holy Spirit basically is saying, Peter, these are your new brothers and sisters. Embrace them. Oh, geez, no, please. This is a struggle for him, and it also is a struggle for us even in our own time. The Spirit calls us to see everyone around us as a brother and sister, that the Holy Spirit can fall on whoever that Spirit wishes to go. The Spirit moves to all people, not just a certain number of people. And so Jesus tells his disciples, proclaim this gospel not to just Jerusalem or part of it, not to just the Jewish people, but go to the ends of the earth. And so Peter has to change his worldview, has to change his ideas about who is worthy of God's goodness and who is not. And he has to see that the entire world, even people who are different than him, even people who in the past he may have shunned and pushed to the side, that this entire world is beloved. This entire world is redeemed by God and not just Israel. That is a tough challenge for Peter. And so what does this feast day mean for us, especially since the Spirit is our patron? Well, first of all, we ask the question, are we lost? Are we worried about something? Are we anxious? Do we sense that something in our world is not quite right? Well, the Spirit can and will guide us if we just let that Spirit in. For Genesis, thousands of years ago, and today, there is darkness, there is an abyss, there is another world that we can't quite figure out. Things seem out of order, but the Spirit can put things right if we just place our confidence in the Spirit. And then there are also all kinds of dry bones in our world, places that are lifeless, places that have no joy. Sometimes we have the dry bones of constant sniping and negativity, especially in our political scene. But the Spirit also can give us new life. It raised Jesus. It can raise us as well. And then also, that Spirit can help us when things aren't always easy. And that Spirit may challenge us as well. The Spirit challenges St. Peter and asks him to change his mind. And the Spirit may come and challenge us at some point. Maybe even right now, you're being challenged by the Spirit. And we are always called to be different than we were before. Maybe we're finding the old ways of living and doing things just aren't working anymore. And so that is the call to change. The Spirit calling us to change each and every day. That Spirit calls us to joy, calls us to a new way of life, calls us to live in the Lord Jesus. And so we pray this morning that we may listen to the Spirit. And if we do, new blessings can come to us if only we are open to the invitation. This morning we pray that we can listen to the Spirit and receive new joy if we can just reject the negative and the difficult in our world. And we pray that we can truly listen to the Spirit and let the new life of God fill us and let that Spirit change us and to be different than the day we were before. Almighty God, we ask you to give us your Spirit, to let that Spirit fill us, to inspire us, to change us, and to give us new life in the Lord Jesus, who lives and reigns forever and ever.